Before that, there was a slideshow that is made. On the last night that we are there with kids, we always have a slideshow that we show the kids, and they get to get a good kick out of seeing their faces up there and yelling out each other's names whenever they see each other. And so we're gonna see this slideshow, and then I'll give my comments and thanks to the congregation, and then hopefully some of you that went have some stories to share on how it impacted throughout the week.
Who's gonna save the world tonight? Who's gonna bring you back to life? We're gonna make
time. I used to look into my father's eyes. In a happy home, I was a king, I had a golden throne. Those days are gone, now the memories around the world. I hear the songs from the places where it.
moving so phenomenally. You're more like the way we rock it. So don't stop, don't stop. Under the lights when everything goes. Nowhere to hide when I'm getting you close. When we move, well, you already know. So just imagine. Creeping up on you, so just dance, dance, dance. Come on. All those things I shouldn't do, but you dance, dance, dance. And ain't nobody leaving soon, so keep dancing.
Keep dancing.
When it drops, I can't take my eyes up off it. Moving so phenomenally. More like the way we rock it. So don't stop.
All right, as I kind of give these acknowledgments, if you were involved with Opportunity Camp, if you could move up to these front pews, doesn't necessarily mean that you need to say anything, but I do want the church to know who all was actually there. And so while they're doing this, David said this morning that this was the smoothest Opportunity Camp that we've had. This is the seventh one that I've been a part of. I was a camper for 4 years. I was an intern twice. And then, obviously, this year as a youth minister, and first off, it had nothing to do with me, okay? A lot of it was set in motion before I even got there. And the adults that we had, Karen went as our nurse, and she was kind of the one that kept me in line and said, okay, now you need to go do this, and now this is planned, and so... I really thank you for that. She put in a ton of work beforehand. Kenny Miller and Charles Robinson we had three maintenance guys. One of them was from Conroe, and they were the other two. And I mean, it's hot in Houston. It's humid in Houston. And they were outside every day fixing air conditioners, toilets, replacing things that the camp desperately needed. And I don't know why, but I think y'all invented some things for y'all to do, put some stuff on the list. And so just incredible. And then Monty Allen and Robin Goss, they were in charge of our crafts, and they got all the supplies and coordinated that. And so the craft time, the high schoolers really love, because this is the time where they kind of the interns and Monty and Robin take over for the little buddies, and they get to go, the high schoolers get to go play volleyball, have a soda, you know, just kind of relax for about an hour, and get a break from their students, or from their little buddies. And then our interns. This camp does not happen without the interns. We have our summer interns, Kyla Baker and Spencer Howdyshell, and then we brought Tyler Wilson and Sydney McMillan, and then Conroe brought four as well, two guys, two girls, and the camp does not happen without them. They bring the energy, things like that. You may have noticed, hey, isn't that Tim up there and Tola? Tim and Tola showed up Sunday night. It was a surprise for the youth group, and so that was a really neat thing. They were a great help for me. I got a lot of questions that I needed to ask of Tim of how to do this job, and so that was a good time for me. And then Conroe's group was just incredible. Their youth ministers were very patient with me, and so all of that kind of led to this being a smooth group. But ultimately, it was the high schoolers. It seems like every year that I've been a part of this group, a part of this camp, there's been at least one high schooler from each, from Canyon and from Conroe, that we go, you know, you probably did more harm than good this week. You know, I hope that you got something out of this, because I don't know if you put anything into this. You know, things like that of having to sit down and have a conversation with someone of, remember why you signed up for this? This wasn't a vacation. That did not happen this year. I could look at every single teen and go, you know what? I'm glad that you were here because of fill in the blank. And it was really neat to see them in that environment. And so for those of you that went, thank you for the sacrifice that you've made for this past week. And so having said that, for any of you that went, want to kind of turn over the floor so you can talk about your experiences, what the impact that this had on you, thanking the church for sending us to this, things along those lines. And so I'm pretty sure this mic is on, right? Okay, so this mic is on for those of you that would like to get up and... Oh, yeah, I can pass it around. I mean, I have no idea what I'm doing. The youth knows this by now, but now it's time. Okay.
Good. I'll probably be better if I go first. But really, when David was talking, when he was talking, the main thing I want to say is, man, we have great kids here. And when I include in the kids are Chris, who just called me Monty Allen, which shows how long I've known him since he was this big, which is kind of fun to be called that. And to even to our interns, who, you know, we loved Spencer before he was born, and he's done a great job. He had to do lots of stuff that most interns wouldn't have to do because Chris wasn't here yet, and so he did a great job, and he's done a great job with your kids, and I can't wait to see what he does. And Tyler and Sydney and Kayla, they all did, Kyla, I'm sorry, they all did such great jobs, and watching so many of them grow up here and having been, almost all of them except Kyla, probably were campers before they were buddies before at this camp before they went, and so it's Kayla. I'm sorry, Kyla. We all keep quit talking to me. Anyway, but I watched your kids do things that I thought I was thinking about it. I watched Faith, you know, comfort and cuddle a little girl that had live lice in her hair. I mean, she'd already cleaned her hair, but just right after that, trying to comfort her, she had to go clean her hair with lice shampoo again. And she didn't, I mean, she may have been thinking about, oh no, I'm going to get lice in my hair, but she didn't act like that. She just did what had to be done and took care of her. And I watched buddies that got no warm and fuzzies from their little buddies, but they still took care of them, made sure they had what they needed, and followed them around camp, tried to make it fun for them. So y'all should be very proud. Who wants the mic?
I guess I'll go next. As Chris said, Kenny and myself and Todd from Conroe, we were kind of the maintenance guys. And you really don't know what you're needing to do until you drive up the road and you're at camp. Kenny kept telling me, you know, I hope they've got a lawnmower that's working. Last year we bought a push mower, and I'm thinking, that's all I'm going to do. 6, 8, 10 hours down, we're doing a push mower. We get there, the whole place has already been shredded. So that was something we didn't have to worry about this year. I did learn a few things, and I wrote them down. Some of them were humorous, some of them were kind of serious. There's a lot to maintenance. There's a whole lot to maintenance. And if there's a maintenance issue in the kitchen, it goes top priority, because eating is important. There's a lot that can go wrong with a toilet. Tim is not scared of a 4-foot bull snake. It's kind of surprised me. Flavor ice at 4 o'clock in the afternoon is unbelievable. When you're in that kind of temperature and that kind of humidity, all you can do is continue to input water. I've got one here. Song 395, if you look that up, talks about if just a cup of water I placed within your hands, someone gives me a cup of water, I'm drinking it down there because it's too hot. It really is. Something else I learned. Aggies have their own rules to 42. But there's not a single Aggie that knows all the Aggie rules to 42. Twin bunk beds with footboards and headboards? Nope. One window air conditioner cannot really keep a cabin with no insulation cool. If I'm the electrician on the job, we are all in trouble. Big buddies love their little buddies. We had a situation this year that one of the young men was a little, I guess the best word is almost out of control. Hit a couple of people, and it was up to the two big buddies, one from Conroe and one from here. If they said, we're sending you home, they would have gone home. Neither one of those guys did. And big buddies will surprise you. They really will.
I'm going to keep it short. Basically, selfless is what I can say. Every single teen, from the interns to the kids, I've watched the slideshow before, but we were so exhausted, I didn't process it till tonight. But selfless. Y'all, I learned from you guys this week on what it is to be selfless, so thank you.
So it was my first year at Opportunity Camp, and I kind of went in there not really knowing what to expect. My sister was kind of trying to scare me, saying, like, these 7-year-olds were going to, like, slit my throat in the middle of the night.
I was being honest. You were prepared.
So whenever I get there, I meet my little buddy. Her name was Emily. And at the start of the week, I kind of got from her, like, she was all shy and quiet. But, like, the more comfortable she got, the more sassy she got. So on Thursday night, we really had a hard time kind of with the one-on-one time. She would not talk. She would just, like, stand in the corner. She wouldn't look at me or my partner. So I kind of asked her, hey, what's going on? And she looked at me, and I'm like, I'm mad at you. I'm like, what'd I do? Did I do something? She goes, you breathed on me. And I was like, okay, I guess you're just tired. I'm just going to let it slide. So what I got from my camp experience is that, man, parenting is hard. I could barely handle a very well-behaved kid for a week. I have no idea how my parents handled my sister.
Just so you know, my sister prepared me very well for op camp, as you can see. One thing that I really got out of op camp this year was how you have to be like you have to be very cheesy excited to get your buddy to do stuff sometimes. And my little buddy, she was very chill. I think she liked napping more than I like napping, and I really like napping. But I knew it's like, okay, we can't take a nap now, even though I want to. We have to go do stuff. And so it's you have to try to hype yourself up, and then you have to try to hype your little buddy up, so you have to be like twice as excited about stuff, and sometimes that can be hard, but honestly, having our amazing interns help, they were excited about everything, or at least acted like it. They got excited about sour cream. But, you know, you just this year I had to learn that it's like you have to be overly excited about everything to get people to do stuff sometimes to the point of cheesiness, and that's okay.
Oh, so this was my second year going to Opportunity Camp, and last year I thought I had a pretty hard buddy, and then I got to this year, and I was proven wrong. But my little buddy loved everything about camp, except for me sometimes, and my partner, she did not always like us, but it was fun just seeing her energy for God and how much she just loved everything about camp. I remember our first one-on-one, it was about David, like David and Goliath. I asked her, I was like, who's David? And she went and told me the entire story of Moses. Because she... So then we told her, like, no, David, like the guy that fought Goliath. And then she went and told us the entire story of David, including how many brothers he had, which I didn't even know. So she just knew she knew so much already. And she was just so excited to learn more, which made it a good week. Another thing about her is she wouldn't go anywhere without her Bible. If she was going to bed, it was in her bed with her, which I thought was really cool. But, it was a good week. It was fun. We learned a lot. Definitely grew closer to God myself through it. So.
All right. Well, this is my third year at Op Camp, and I had a little girl who was 8 years old. Her name is Dulce, and that means sweet or candy in Spanish. And she was bilingual, and she was just a little firecracker. As she got more comfortable, like Devin was saying, she got really sassy, and it was pretty cute. But she broke down a few times near the end of camp. But for the most part, she was a pretty good kid. Like Monty was saying, though, like one thing about Dulce was the first day that they get there, if the kids have lice, they have to go to what we call beauty shop. And I've never had beauty shop or a kid with lice. And so this year I was told, Faith, you're going to beauty shop. I was like, okay, just mentally prepare myself. And we got up there and we ended up spending, I think, about 3 hours before she could actually enter the camp and do anything in the camp because she had lice so bad. And it got to where, like, after we cleaned her hair and treated it and did a whole bunch of stuff to it, to where, like, we just picked out, we couldn't even pick out all of the lice in her hair at the time. We just picked out the ones that were alive, which is really gross, but it's pretty sad too, because both of her brothers had lice also, and they were also up there. But it just kind of went to show me that, like, the whole time she was there for 3 hours, let's just picking out her hair and pulling and nagging and trying not to tell her she has lice or that she can't go play with the other kids. And it's just kind of, it's kind of upsetting for a little kid to watch everybody else go have fun while it's like, hey, we're going to go to beauty shop and treat your hair again. And it's no fun for them, and I feel bad for them. But the whole thing with Dulce was is that she sat there the whole time not complaining, not asking when we were done. She probably said two words the whole time we were treating her hair. And it showed me and my partner a whole lot of patience. And it showed us that, like, her burden kind of was, like, her lice in her hair. And, like, even though it was, like, growing on her head, it was, like, no matter her burden, she was going to have a good time. And she was going to have fun. And she was going to learn the Word of God, no matter her burdens. And she just kind of left those behind. And so that's definitely one thing I got this year out of camp, was just kind of leave your burdens behind. Because even if your burden is growing on top of your forehead, like, she was able to have a great week and learn a lot about God and do it without complaining. So that's what I learned.
So this was my first year at camp too. And like Devin, I didn't have anyone to tell me how good my experience would be or how bad it would be. So I didn't really know what to expect either. So I came in, and the only thing I really wanted was like a buddy without lies. And then I ended up getting Dulce's brother, Jose. And he had lots of lice, and I was trying not to get the shampoo in my hands, so I was trying to get my partner to do it for him, so I wouldn't have to get any lice in my hands. But I ended up doing it anyways. And Jose, he's pretty quiet at the beginning, and he's kind of homesick. But towards the end, we thought he was gonna be pretty sweet at the beginning, and then he started getting a little bit wild, and he's like throwing water on stuff and people. And but anyways, he did start listening to us during camp, and it was definitely a great experience to see Jose learn more about God and then ask questions and kind of see it all click together, I guess. So.
I had a little buddy, and her name was Allison. It was my first time coming, so I had no clue what to expect. From all the stories I heard, I was like prepared to have a really tough buddy, but I was surprised at how chill she was. Though really, at first, it'd be hard to talk to her. She mostly communicated through. But eventually, she'd eventually start to talk to you. One-on-one time, though, was especially hard because she wouldn't really respond to her question. She'd be like, I don't know. And we're like, oh, you could just follow along in the Bible with us that we got you. And she's like, I can't read well in English. So we're just like, and so even the little activities we did, we told her to like do a little poster with a memory verse on it and decorate it. She just wrote the memory verse and that was it. But like, despite barely like retaining most of the information that the little buddies got, she did eventually learn her memory verse, which I was happy about. She's excited to say it anytime she could. And she at least knew about Jesus, which was good enough for me. I was thinking, like, opportunity camp is an opportunity camp for a reason. It's an opportunity for a little buddies to come and experience this and eventually build a foundation. So I have a feeling when she comes back, she'll be able to learn more and retain more. Really, she wasn't much of a problem, though, except she would never remember my name. She knew some of the other older buddies. She knew all the kids. She knew my partner, but she would never remember my name. It's Ariel. It's like one of the most memorizable names. But anyway, besides like giving us the silent treatment one time, she's a really good buddy, and I was glad to experience it.
This was my fourth year to go, and I think I would agree totally that the kids from Conroe and University got together so well, worked together, no real issues. And it's always a blessing for me to see the kids and the interns. I mean, they really are the hands and feet of Jesus. They do whatever it takes to make sure those buddies have a good time, that they're taken care of. And I mean, it's such a growing experience for them, and it's truly just such a blessing for us to see. I mean, we're busy. I mean, we kind of see it in glances here and there. You know, we're not always there to see every step of the way, but when you do kind of catch those glimpses, you can just see the relationships grow. You see the kids bonding. Yeah, they're sassy, they lash out, But these kids don't know it because they're not parents yet, but that's every kid all the time. So they've been there, they've done it, they just don't realize it. So, I mean, that's just kids being kids, kind of testing you out as the kind of the guardian for the day. But, you know, these kids really were, as their shirts show, superheroes. They were amazing with these kids, and it was just a real blessing to see.
So it was my third year to go, and I had a sweet little buddy. She, I mean, pretty typical. She was quiet at first and then got an attitude. And my partner, my other big buddy, we ended up being very similar. And so that was really cool to just form that friendship with her, because we still text and talk about like the week. And it's just really cool to see what came from that whole experience. But one of my favorite parts of the week was Sunday morning when we went to Impact Church. I always go, and they have like a bilingual service, and so I never took Spanish in school, but I still try and sing the songs in Spanish anyways, and it doesn't sound anything like it. But I just sat there this time, and I was singing in Spanish, or trying to at least. And I just kept thinking how cool it was that we're singing like the same words to the same God, but it's so, like, it's such a different language. And I mean, that thought just carrying through the week. I mean, these kids were coming from completely different backgrounds, but we're all there to serve the same God, and the same God loves us each the same. And I mean, as different as we feel as big buddies with our little buddies and what we have to go through with them, I mean, it's all the same, and it's all the same love, and it's all just such an encouragement to see all the different people coming together. And what was really cool, Impact Sunday when we went, it's always Senior Sunday when we're there, but this year there was a baptism. And so the guy baptizing him, you know, had to translate everything he was saying to Spanish and English. And, I mean, it was so neat to me to just see, I mean, same water, same love, same, I mean, he's receiving the same Holy Spirit. And it was just really neat to see all that get connected and put together.
All righty. Well, this was my fourth year, so I had three other buddies before this time. And so I kind of knew what to expect. My freshman year, Tim kind of threw me under the bus and gave me the hardest buddy, in my opinion. So I was like, you know, it can't get worse from there. So Tim was asking me before they went and got the buddies kind of what I wanted, since it was my senior year and I was one of the only seniors. And so I was like, you know what, Tim, just give me the hardest one out there. I just want a really athletic girl that'll run away from me, so I'll go and get her, and I'll handle her. And so that was my thing, is that if she's athletic, then most likely, like, a small child is going to be athletic, so they're going to be pretty small because they're fast and stuff. So I meet my little buddy, and her name is London, and she is 8 years old, and this girl's big. I consider myself, as an athlete, to eat a lot. This girl ate more than me. And the whole time I'm thinking, you know, this is good. This is awesome. Like, she's a big eater. Like, I don't have to tell her, like, to eat stuff. But the longer I sat there and watched her, the longer I realized, the more she eats, the heavier she's going to be for me to carry. And so throughout the week, I was really good about not giving her any piggyback rides or anything the first day, because once you introduce your ability of giving a piggyback ride, you're done the rest of the week. You know, it's going to be every time, shoulders, shoulders, back. And so anyway, I didn't introduce it, but then she's like, oh, I need a piggyback ride. So I gave her a piggyback ride, and then it didn't stop. And so she just kept eating, and it seems like my legs just kept dying. And so this girl, she was really awesome. The way I saw God this week was her reminding me of what a Christian should be like. I find myself going through the motions a lot and reading the Bible, but maybe not really getting anything out of reading it. Like, yeah, I'm reading my Bible, but what did it say? And so I would be reading some stories to London, and she would be listening. And so then I would turn around and be like, all right, so what does that mean? And she would recite it just like that. She could tell me almost word for word what I just read. And I was sitting there going, oh, I actually didn't remember what I just read. Thank you for reminding me, because I read the entire story and I wasn't really paying attention myself. And so she reminded me of being a Christian isn't easy at all, and that you can't go through the motions. You have to be willing to sit and listen, but also interpret and realize what you're doing and what you're saying.
So this is my eighth year to have gone, and I love Opportunity Camp. From a parent standpoint, you guys can be very proud of all your kids. I feel very fortunate, and I think the other parents can see that, can feel the same way. I feel fortunate to be able to watch your kids. Gary and I have taught huddles for a long time, and we get to see them on Wednesday nights and get to know them that way. But Opportunity Camp just gives us a whole new perspective. We get to see them from sunup to way past sundown, and some of them really have a lot of challenges. And so it's a really neat thing to see, and I want to encourage all of you parents at any point, if you have any time, any June, to go to Opportunity Camp and witness what Opportunity Camp is about. I really encourage you to do that. I'll go as long as I can, and as long as there's no other parent who can take the medical aspect, I'll just continue to go because it is such a blessing. And one of the things I learn is that it's a small portion of what I think heaven's going to be like with, as in the way of unity. I see these kids and the Conroe kids together, working together. We see very little, at least from our standpoint, we see very little drama, and us adults get to work with Conroe adults, and it's just a really neat thing to see how we all kind of mesh together. When we go into Impact on Monday morning to go get the kids, I do the last check, and the youth ministers are dividing the kids, and so we never really know, and I want to say this to everyone, mainly to the kids, we don't know, I don't know who's going to get who, so it's not like we can say, hey, Gage didn't want to have to deal with lice, so we'll make sure he gets one. It's just, you know, the luck or the unluck of the draw. So I've never really said that out loud to them, so I wanted them to know it's not because we do that purposefully at all. So it's just such a blessing, and I appreciate going, and I have stories, and I know all the adults have stories about every single one of your children, and I'll be happy to visit with you afterwards and let you know. They all did really well, and you can be very proud of your children.
All right, so I went to Opportunity Camp as a big buddy when I was in high school, and I'm back as an intern. I'm in college. What I saw this week was a lot of selflessness, a lot of love that came from the big buddies directed towards the little buddies. And it was kind of a different perspective from when I was a big buddy in their shoes. I really was able to see that in the impact that it had on the kids and the power it had to convert, to show the love of God to those kids. And I really, like, I saw that and saw the opportunity that we had to show that same selflessness, the same love to other kids our age, to other adults, to other young adults. And I was really, like, pondering, like, why is it so much different? Like, why is, like, the selflessness, like, so evident here? Why? And I think it's because of how difficult the little kids are. But it really, like, revealed to me how much love matters in the process of, like, trying to reveal the gospel to people, to really show the love of God to people, and that it is really one of the main aspect in that. And I just, that's what I saw this week. And I saw it through all the big buddies and how they acted with their little buddies, and how the little buddies' needs always came first, no matter what it was or how ridiculous it was or what they wanted. It was just, it was all about them and pleasing them. And through that, the little buddies were able to, you know, see God, I think. So that's what I saw.
There's always so much to think about this camp. This camp is such a blessing. Getting to go back as an intern, wow, that was fun. I never thought I would get to go back to Opportunity Camp, and then my opportunity came, bam, pun. But what I wanted to say is echoing what everyone says. Be proud of these people who went, each and every one of them, because you can see this little glimpse of the glory of Christ that is in us. Guys who graduated out, it was their first round when it was my last year. And I got to see that with some of the Conroe kids too. These same people like, hey, Spencer, I remember you. I'm like, oh, cool, I remember you. What a time it's been. And in that time, it's like we look the same and we feel the same. And we shared memories from 3 years ago when we were together. The spiritual maturity didn't even compare. The love that these kids showed and how they had, it didn't compare. What they wanted to do with these little buddies wasn't just have the best buddy or to be the most glamorous or be well out there. It was just to love them with nothing for them and nothing for themselves, no outcome. They didn't care if they were the best big buddy or the worst or whatever. They just wanted to love and do as much as they could for this little person with the thought that they might not have this themselves. And over again, I was amazed by the love. There was this one little kid when we went to Impact. He was Hunter Miller's little kid. And we walk into Impact and he's just fighting me and another Conroe intern, just punching us in the gut, punching us, slapping us in the face. And we had to hold him back, you know. And they all had to hold him back just because of how aggressive he was. I was like, I hope this guy isn't in my room. And I hoped wrong, he was in my room. But so was Hunter. And so was Hunter. Because you would get to see, and over the first night, after the first night, this really long night of being up, you know, with this kid, he finally opened up and he would calm down. And he started loving and he started listening to these lessons over and over again. He became so cool. He would share jokes with you and he'd tell you about this one time, you know, at his house, you know, so on, so on. But it really hit me, the love I got from him, or the love that Hunter was pouring into him on the last day when, you know, the interns come back when they're asleep or trying to go to sleep and they go back to get a snack before bedtime. And JoJo's kind of crying. And I go up to him, I'm like, JoJo, what's up? He goes, I can't fall asleep. My big buddy usually scratches my back until I fall asleep. Will you scratch my back? It's like, man, yeah, I'll scratch your back. I don't want to, but I will. And so I scratched this kid's back because Hunter did. And because of the love he was shown, he was able to fall asleep and feel comfortable with where he was. Again, there's so many stories like that, over and over again. And being on the other side of the table, it was fun. But glory be to God over and over again for being with these kids and being with our kids and the Conroe kids, because it was a great trip once again.
So I've been crying through like this whole thing, so bear with me. This was my second year to go as an intern, and sorry. If I'm being super honest, I was not prepared to go. I was tired, I had a lot on my mind, and I had a whole 10-hour bus ride to get my mind where it needed to be, and it still was not where it needed to be. And Sunday morning, like Emily said, the first thing that happens when we get to church is we gain a new brother in Christ. And slowly, during that worship service, God just started reminding me, hey, you're here. You're here for a reason. And we had that Sunday to kind of just get ready, and Monday morning, the interns and a couple of the other people, we went to Impact to pick the kids up. And as soon as I walk in the door, here comes Lillian. And this was Callie's buddy. And this girl is almost as big as I am, if I'm being really honest. And she comes and she takes my arms and she shoves me into the wall. And I have no like power against her. I'm just like against this wall, you know. I can't really fight back as much as I want to, but I just again think like, I'm not ready for this week. I'm tired. I'm not mentally or physically prepared. And the past couple months, I've had this reoccurring theme of being present. I have struggled tremendously with just being in the moment, with being present. And just being present and meaning it. And this week, it reminded me how blessed I am to be a child of God. It reminded me that the little problems that I think are big, it reminded me that I have such a big God that those problems don't matter. It was kind of in the middle of the week. It's pool time, and pool time is awful. Like, this pool is dirty. There's little hooligans all over the place, and I just don't like swimming. But I'm talking to Robin about some stuff, and I'm telling her about some stuff that I'm kind of struggling with, and she said, dude, God's got it. God's got it. And this is in the middle of the week, and I'm an intern, and I'm supposed to be having all this energy, and I'm thinking of all these other things that are tearing me down. Kind of like Faith said, just that burden. And the first night we were there, I got our girls together, and I just wanted to visit with them for a little week and just let them know, like, if there's anything I can do for y'all this week, please let me know. And then I started talking out of a scripture that has been on my mind. It comes out of John, and it just talks about abiding. And when you really learn to abide in God and abide in the Word and be present, then that's when things really start to fall into place. And just seeing the kids this week from going to op camp last year to going down to Impact with Buffs for Christ over spring break till now, and just seeing the growth in those kids, it's God. It's God, and that's, like I said, He's so big, and I'm so blessed to be a part of this group. For whatever reason, they asked me to come back, and I'm so blessed, and just the growth I've seen in our kids. See, I'm lucky because I go to school here, so I get to see from last summer to this summer the growth in some of these girls and the blessing they've been to me, the blessing this church has been to me. Just the fact of getting to go this week was incredible. So I'm going to stop because I'm just rambling. So I think that's it.
Thank you, church, for sending us to this. This is impossible without your support. Even though we do the work, we can't do it without you. Let's close with a prayer. Dear Father, we love you so much. We thank you for this opportunity that we got to see what sacrifice was like, Father Lord. Lord, as we went out, we tried to be your hands and your feet to these children that they may not get that at home. Lord, and right now I just pray for those kids that now they are in their homes, and we don't know what they had to go back to, Father Lord, but it's probably definitely worse than what they had this past week with us. And Lord, we ask that their homes are receptive
and that light that we've ignited, hopefully, Father Lord, that it's not snuffed out by those around them, by their friends, by their family, Lord, and that we can see them again next year, Father Lord. Lord, thank you for this group as we say just edified one another as we went through this week and may continue throughout the rest of this summer and throughout the rest of their Christian lives, Father Lord. Lord, we thank you for your Son, for being the ultimate sacrifice, for showing us what obedience actually was, Father Lord. That's in your name we pray. Amen.